you guys heard me. Together. I'm so glad to be in the house of the Lord. How many know that the Bible says that there is joy in the house of the Lord? Amen. And I want to pray, God, that I want to pray to the Lord that joy would overflow in us today as we worship Him. We're coming together to worship our Lord and our Savior. He has given and sacrificed everything for us. And Lord, today I pray, God, that we would exalt You. We would place You above all else in our lives. God, we worship You, Lord. Help us to worship it in spirit and in truth, Lord God. And let there be joy in the house of the Lord today as we worship You, as we exalt You. And Lord, as we declare Your greatness here in this place today. We love You, Jesus. We thank You for this time.
So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's
Yes, Jesus, you're amazing. You're so great, God. We love you, Lord. Oh, we just declare, God, your greatness here in this place.
We've only scratched the surface. Thank you.
Yes, Lord, we're crying out for heaven to fall. Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done here in this place, here in our hearts, Lord God, as it is in heaven. Lord, we pray, God, that we would be, Lord, kingdom people, Lord God. That as we cry out to you, as we worship you, Lord God, you deposit in us, Lord, heaven, Lord God, the keys of heaven, Lord God, that we would be effective, Lord God, for your kingdom come, your will be done. We do ask, God, heaven to fall here in this place. Thank you, Jesus.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop. You never
the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Oh, we love you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Answered, I
I've noticed that there's people that have pain in their bodies and hurt in their physical bodies, and then also finances can be hard, life struggles can be hard, and just as we're thinking about this song, I trust in God, reminded me of Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes, but fear the Lord and depart from evil. Why? It'll be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. I believe God is coming with the grace this morning for us to cast our burdens upon him and trust in him in a genuine way that brings a peace to even our physical bodies, that there's a weight lifted off of our shoulders, that there's a pain released maybe from our gut and our stomach and the tension we carry. Maybe some of you struggle with tension headaches. But I believe God is coming today with just a fresh breath of his presence that says, I'm here and I see you. Will you trust me today? And this is what I want to do. If you're willing to say, God, I trust you today, would you just close your eyes and lift up your hands and begin to declare the Lord, God, I trust you today. Come on, open up your mouth and say, God, I trust you with all of my heart, with all of my soul, with all of my mind, with all of my strength. And I believe, God, that as I trust you, that you will become a way maker in my life, that miracles will be released, that finances will be released, that provision will come, that healing will come, the open doors. God, our trust in you is an avenue for the miraculous. So as we sing this just a moment longer, I ask you to lift your hands with full surrender to the Lord. Come on, church, lift your hands. The Bible says to lift your hands before him. Let's tell the Lord, God, we surrender. We surrender to you and we trust you afresh, oh God. We trust you with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul. God, we know that you are the answer. We know that you are the way maker. And so, God, we trust you. Come on, let's sing that together.
Yes, Lord Jesus. Oh, oh. Oh, I trust in God.
God, we do trust you. Father, we trust you for today. We trust you for tomorrow. We trust you for the decades to come. God, that we will be patient in our trusting. God, that we will continue to turn our eyes to you. Lord, even if the answer doesn't come today or tomorrow, but God, we know that you are working even when we don't see it. So God, we rest in that. God, we take the burden off of us and we place it on you, and we rest in and enjoy your presence. We enjoy your peace. God, we know that you are faithful in every season. Lord, you are faithful to every generation, the Bible says. So, Father, we choose to trust you and not take things into our own hands and try to finagle an answer for ourselves. But, God, we continue to resurrender each day our emotions and our heart. And God, and believe, Lord, that you are working even when we don't see it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give God some glory this morning. Amen. Guys, I really do believe Eddie even just shared with me that it's important to remember that we don't give up, but we continue to trust in each season, even if we don't understand the answers, but we believe in his character, we trust in his goodness, we trust in his love and his faithfulness. So even when you don't see the answer, I encourage you, church, to keep your heart at rest and know that he's working on your behalf. Amen? Amen. Thank you, worship team. You guys are awesome. How's everybody doing today? You guys doing well? Doing well. You may be seated. Awesome. Just a couple quick announcements for you guys this morning. If you're visiting with us today, we would love to welcome you to Lake Tahoe Christian Fellowship. Our ushers have a welcome card for you that has a spot on there where we could do a little prayer request for you. If you're visiting, could you just raise your hands? And we'd love to welcome you guys here, church family. Could you just greet those who are visiting? I see one right here. Ushers, if you could see them back here too. Church, give them a clap, guys. And then raise your hands, visitors. Sorry. I told you to clap and raise your hand. That was really confusing. So people were like, what do I do? Do I clap with my hands up? I don't know how to do this. If you're visiting, make sure you flag down an usher. Do we need seats in the back? Are we good? If anyone has seats, we have seats over here. There's plenty of seats over here if you guys are looking for seats. Awesome. Well, welcome, visitors. Like I said, we do have a spot on the welcome card that will give you a place for you to put in prayer requests. We are honored to get to pray with you and believe for God just to move on your behalf and bless your life in miraculous ways. Really special, on April 28th, we are going to do water baptisms. Yeah, so fun. So what we're going to do is there's signups online where you can get on there and register to get water baptized. And then that Sunday morning during the service, we're going to take you downstairs and do a quick class with you, make sure you really understand what it means to be water baptized, and hear from you if you have any questions or concerns. Talk it through with you. I know some people do have questions about what does it mean to be water baptized and why we do it. But basically, it's a public declaration of our faith that we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, and we are making it official that we have decided to pledge our allegiance to Jesus Christ. As Lucas has said, I don't know if you remember, a couple weeks ago with Lucas was here, and he was sharing about faith is pledging your allegiance, right? Who we pledge our allegiance to. So April 28th, we will be doing water baptisms. And then now, Fred, if you want to come on up, we have a really special announcement here. This is our dear friend Fred, and he is going to share with you guys a little bit of information about what's happening today.
Good morning, church. How are you? Oh, I don't know. You can do better than that. I heard you worshiping. How are we doing this morning? That's a Lake Tahoe worship greeting right there. My name is Fred Hammer. I'm with Johnny and Friends, and I work with Johnny Erickson Tata, and we're going to have a special presentation after church today to learn more about her ministry. But briefly, in 1967, Johnny took a dive into a lake, and it was a shallow dive and broke her neck. And at the age of 17, she became a member of the largest minority group in the United States that also is one that we can join at any moment, and that's the minority group of those impacted by disability. It can happen to us at any time, at any point in our life, whether we're born with it or we influence it sometime later through an accident. But 1 in 5 people is impacted by disabilities. And to challenge a community, to challenge a church means if you're looking straight ahead and you look to your left, and then we look to our right, maybe we look behind us, we need to recognize and realize that there is someone that should be impacted by a disability right next to us. And the challenge becomes for a church, which is why we're excited to be able here to intentionally strategize and help the Waymakers ministry that's starting here to be more intentional in ministry and in reaching and welcoming those impacted by disabilities, is if we don't see people in our church impacted by disabilities, now granted some are invisible, but if we do not see them, sometimes we need to ask, why is that? Why is there such a large people group in our community that love Jesus, that need Jesus, that need to be part of his church? And how can we find them and encourage them and get them to be part of our body so that God can use the gifts and talents that he's given to them to be able to minister and reach the community around us? And that's why I'm excited to be part of Johnny and Friends, because that's what we're about. We're not a program. We are a ministry that comes alongside, that builds up, that encourages the people in the church, that comes alongside those that love Jesus Christ and says, how can we help you be more effective and more intentional with ministry and loving to those around us? And sometimes it's just education, right? Sometimes we just need to know, well, gosh, what do I do? What do I say? What can we do as a congregation? And they're real simple things, but sometimes it's just being that strategy and being strategic about that. And so that's what we're going to be talking about later after church today. We'd love to have you join us downstairs. The Libby's have provided a nice little snack for us down there. But we're going to go in a little bit deeper about how we as a community can reach and minister those right here in Lake Tahoe, and how can we as a church continue to grow and impact further and further those impacted by disability. Because we are not just wanting a church that has people in our church that have disabilities, but disabilities should be part of the church, because God has created every single one of us uniquely. Amen? We are created in God's image. We are created with the gifts and talents that he has given each one of us. Whether or not we can see, whether or not we can touch, whether or not we can walk, whether or not we have some challenges that help us focus, God has a purpose for every single person he's created. And you know what? There's a lot of people out there that need to hear that. They need to know that they've got a purpose. They need to know that Lake Tahoe Fellowship here loves them. They need to know that this is a place they can come and be lifted up. They can be encouraged. They can have support in life. And they have a place where they can find belonging. Because when we belong together in the body of Christ, we can change the world. We can change the world. And that's what we're about. Pastor Alex, thanks for letting me share. I hope you'll join us after church. We'll be downstairs.
Thank you, Fred. It's so important what he's sharing. We believe that God sees everyone, right? And everyone is special. And we really encourage you after service to head downstairs to the multipurpose room down there, connect with Bart and Nancy and Fred, and they're going to have some food for you and some snacks and some great information for you. So at this time, we're going to go ahead and receive the tithes and offerings. There's the basket in the back. And visitors, you can drop your welcome cards in there if you would like, or you could hand them to an usher. And also you can give online if you would like to do that. So Lord, I just thank you so much for each person here. And I just pray a blessing over the finances of every home in this place. God, that you would give us wisdom on how to manage our finances and steward them well. You would give us generous spirits, Lord, that are willing to give to those in need and to be generous with those, Lord, who you've called us to be generous with. So Father, we just speak a blessing over the finances of each home in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to take a moment to dismiss the children. If you want to stand and greet somebody next to you while the kids walk really slowly downstairs, really calmly, and just introduce yourself to somebody new and say hello.
Get started. This is going to be fun. Well, it's going to be fun for me, all right? I hope you're going to have fun, too. Guys, this is going to be great. What a beautiful weekend we're having. Did you guys enjoy the faux? It's not snow. It's faux. Faux snow. Faux snow. That was not snow. Who said 88% chance of snow this weekend? Man, who said that? That's what we call a wolf ticket. Back in the 80s, we called that a wolf ticket, right? Crying wolf. All right. Hey, I wanna share some things with you this morning. I'm really excited for where we're at in the scriptures today. For some people, what I'm gonna share today is just, man, You've known this from the beginning. Others, it's going to be a drink from the fire hose. I'm going to share a lot of scriptures with you today because I am excited about the scriptures. The topic that I'm going to talk about today is almost inexhaustible. It's almost inexhaustible in the scriptures. And so I'm excited to share it. And I could have just, you know, done the Sesame Street. You know what I mean? But I used to be a junior high youth pastor, okay? And I was commissioned by God to be a junior high youth pastor after I had done a whole lot of other ministry. I'd been a traveling evangelist. I had been a college course director. I had directed some courses at the university level. I had done a lot of things in ministry, and then my assignment became junior high, and it was a lot of fun. I've got a lot of feedback up here. I'm so sorry. Is it me? Am I feeding back? Let it echo to the nations. Okay. So good. Sorry, guys. I love you. This is fun. I don't care. It's just an echo. And what was I saying? Oh, so when I was a junior high leader, I felt my mission and my commission was that, hey, those junior hires are really smart. So I held nothing back, as you would imagine, as I would do. And I used to say it like this. I will do my Harvard study for Wednesday night junior high when I was teaching the word. And I will do my best to communicate it in Sesame Street style. So because I wanted both. It's like the truth is the truth. And so when I was saying to myself, when Levi came home yesterday and said, so... Sarah said, what are you working on? I said, well, I got to go do a complete mention on the mystery revealed. And Levi goes, oh, Dad, please don't. Please don't. It was really funny because he knew, Dad, you're going to take it too far. People are going to get confused. And I hope not, because what we're going to talk about today, like I said, is almost inexhaustible in the scriptures. So at least take pictures or take notes of the addresses that I'm going to give you today in the scriptures, because each one of them is an absolute feast of what God is doing in the earth today. And it shows that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That what he was up to way back when, he's up to that right now. Right? What he was doing in the beginning, he is doing now. His plan of redemption began literally before the world existed. He began the plan of redemption. And he was working it, friends, even up to this day. Right now, you feel like you're getting older. And if you're like me, just having a dream about running, I can pull a muscle. Right? But there is something that God is doing in you that doesn't matter how old you get, how many aches and pains you have, if this old tent is wearing away, God is doing something new in us. He has a plan of redemption for you. This life is but a breath of vapor, a moment, and God has an intention to live with you forever and enjoy your company forever. And that is what I'm going to be talking about today. But we are in the book of Colossians, and by the way, I got to say that I'm going to do my best to get this done in a timely manner, because I want you to get downstairs for those of you that are already feeling the tug in your heart to be a part of what is going on with Waymakers, and with the fact that we have Johnny and friends in-house today, and that you can maybe receive something from them and receive an impartation from them. I know that many of you have served in so many different areas of ministry to this community over the years. Some of you are brand new to the church, but I'm just sensing that we kind of have a moment right now. I'm sorry, I kind of segued away to talking about Fred. Okay, I'm sorry I did that. But we kind of have a moment where it seems like there's an open window for us to be available for this community that Fred Hammer was talking about. Okay, so Fred, you're going to be leading that whole thing, right? So you're going to be the master of ceremonies, right, downstairs? So go downstairs and hang out with MC Hammer. Okay, had to do that. That was good. That was good. It was so 80s. My 80s brain never turns off.
Hammer time.
All right, be downstairs for hammer time. You do have the pants, right? You're going to put the pants on? No? No? Okay, all right, forget about it. I'm so sorry. I cannot turn. See, junior high leader, cannot turn it off. It's unbelievable. We have been, if you're new to Lake Tahoe Christian Fellowship, or maybe you haven't been with us for very long,
We have been working through the book of Colossians. We are currently in Colossians chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. And it's been a few weeks since I've had an opportunity to preach through or teach through some of these scriptures. But we have been having a good time. At least I've been having a good time in Colossians. I realized that even though I'd studied this passage of scripture again and again in different seasons of my life, I had never actually taught it or preached on it systematically. And so this season that we've been in Colossians has been very rich time for me as your pastor enjoying his job. and then also getting to share with you some of the just beautiful things that the Word has to say to us. This letter that was written to a church in Asia Minor some 2,000 years ago, nearly 2,000 years ago, still has incredible truths that are relevant to us today. And we have been discovering that as we look into these scriptures, that what Paul the Apostle was writing to this church that he had never met, it was one of his disciples that had actually gone and planted this church. Epaphras was one of his number one guys that had gone and been a missionary like Paul, and he being one who was most likely from Colossae, he went back as he became a wholehearted follower of Jesus and a disciple of Jesus and a student of Paul. He, as a missionary, went back to his hometown, preached the gospel, and planted a church in Colossae. And Paul, being so excited about the multiplication of the kingdom, not just the addition, but the multiplication of the kingdom of God through his ministry and through those that had been sent out through his ministry, he was now in prison and hanging out, having a time with this young man, Epaphras, his disciple, who had come to visit him in prison. And Epaphras was telling him what was going on in the city of Colossae. And so through that time that they spent together in dialogue as to what was happening there, and literally praying, who knows, for days, hours and days, maybe even weeks, praying for Colossae and that church, Paul penned this letter to them. And so even though he had not met them personally, he felt as though he was a father to them. And so he's writing this, and where we were talking in just the last time we were in Colossians, I'm going to back up a few verses to Colossians 1, verse 24. Paul the Apostle said, "I now rejoice in what I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's affliction for the sake of his body, which is the church." And Paul the Apostle had been teaching just in the verses before about what the body of Christ is, that the body is that Jesus is the head of the body, which is the church. And we learned as we were going through those verses that Jesus loves the church. I mean, deeply loves the church, right? I mean, understand that when Jesus declared on the cross, "It is finished," he was saying it to his Father. He was saying, "Father, I have completed everything that you sent me to do." And in the most unmatched expression of selfless love, Jesus gave up his perfect life, sinless life, as an exchange for Alex, for you, for me. And we became the body of Christ, literally. We became the family of God. We became the body of Christ. And Jesus, with every ounce of selfless love, gave himself so that we could be a faith community like we are right now and love and support one another the way Christ was an example for us to live. He became our King. He became our Lord. He became the icon of the way that we should now live under his leadership. Wow, what an amazing thing. So what we discovered is that it is not possible to love Jesus and not love the church. That's what we discovered. Because how can you say that you don't love the church? If you say you like me and you hate my children, we got a problem. It's pretty simple. It's pretty simple. I've put you in a category that I don't want to put people in a category of, right? But the reality is, if somebody hates God's children, or hates literally, Jesus calls it his body, right? It's revealed as his body. Well, then it's just confusing. It's just confusing. But I know there's not any problems with that here. Because you're in the church, and you're here, and you're on a journey. And you're figuring out that the best thing that God has given you is repentance and forgiveness. The very best thing that you have is that God has welcomed you to repent of your sins. And that he is willing to forgive you of your sins. And then we get to go out and forgive those who sin against us. Yay! Woo-hoo-hoo! Yay! Let's do it. Let's go. Go get them. No, it's a hard thing to do, isn't it? But it's what we're called to do, because there's an example that literally invites us into this miraculous relationship with the Creator God. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void. That's what Genesis 1 says. Well, that presence, God, who created all things, is the one who desires to have relationship with you and I. Yeah. What an invitation. And what I'm going to read to us right now, and really where we are at in the scriptures, Paul the Apostle, he says, I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regards to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. And we learned that there is no insufficiency in what Christ did on the cross to purchase redemption for you and I. That's not what Paul is making reference to here when he says what is still lacking. What he's making reference to very simply, which I took a long time to talk about it last time we talked, but very simply, when Jesus gave the Great Commission to go into all the world and to preach the gospel to every nation, but first wait for the gift of the Father, or the promise of the Father, so that when you are sent, you'll be endued with power, that means dunamis power from God, to go and be obedient to do that Great Commission. And so what Paul the Apostle is saying is that even though the all-sufficient sacrifice of Christ was on the cross, he determined that he would not impact the world without you and I. That he gave us himself, his Holy Spirit, so we could be the ones who go out as his ambassadors to proclaim his truth. And that is that Christ was crucified for your sins. Therefore, repent and be baptized and know him. Wow, what an invitation. And so Paul says, look, I was commissioned to do it, and I am hard about it, and I will bear in my body whatever it takes to fulfill the assignment to proclaim the gospel to the ends of the earth, and I am doing it for your sake, he says. But literally, you and I are invited to do the same things. The sacrifices that we make for the sake of the body, which is the church, are literally us bearing or identifying with the work that Christ did. We too, like him, can suffer for the sake of the gospel. Yay, we get to suffer. But a big part of that suffering is really just obedience, because it's our flesh that's suffering to do the will of God. Right? Just like when I was talking about, yay, we get to forgive those who trespass against us. Ugh. That's hard. So, I'm not even to the verses. I'm supposed to be 26 and 27. So let's get there. Verse 25, he says, I have become its servant. The its is referring to the body of Christ. I have become the servant of the body of Christ by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness. We recall that Paul the Apostle was Saul, who was persecuting the church, was on a journey to a city called Damascus, where he was going to persecute the church even more. And while he was on the way, Jesus confronted him and said, why do you persecute me? And literally talking about his persecution of the church. And when he did that, he also gave Saul a commission, and he told him, he actually sent a man to him, And he sent that man with a message that said, I have chosen you to be my mouthpiece, my chosen vessel, and how much you will suffer for the sake of the Gentiles. Now, you got to understand, Saul of Tarsus was anything but a Gentile. He was the best Jew. He was a Jew of Jews, and he had such a high pride in his Jewdom, his Jewness, all right, his Jewness, that literally he at that time in his life could not wrap his mind around the value of a Gentile. What is a Gentile, by the way? I'll tell you. A Gentile is everyone that's not a Jew. So it just means everyone else, all right? Let's just satisfy ourselves finally that what that word Gentile means, it basically, it's most of us in this room and everybody that's not a Jew, and specifically not a practicing Jew, right? So it was possible to be from Israel and not be surrendered to Yahweh. And so that person was even though they had received the promises from God, they were not living up to the promises that were given them, and so they were on the downside of those promises, right? The Mosaic covenant was actually a conditional covenant, and you had to get in line with what was promised to you in order to reap its benefits. So at any rate, what was happening here in verse 25, Paul says, I have become a servant by the commission of God. He goes, man, God gave me an assignment to present to you the word of God in its fullness. And that phrase, word of God in his fullness, is where Paul the apostle had received his biggest revelation in his life. And what he understood was how, what God was doing in Christ. What Yahweh, Father God, was doing in Christ, his son, Jesus, his son, for the sake of the Gentiles. Now, you got to understand, Saul, or Paul the apostle, who eventually became Paul the apostle, he didn't have a value for this revelation. He didn't understand it. And yet it became to him the fulfillment of all that he knew, like a scholar. He was the best of the best, at the very top 1% of his class, if you will, the Pharisees. This guy thought he understood the purpose of God, and yet he was blinded to it. So much so that when he was knocked off that horse on the way to, where was he going? Oh, so good. You guys are paying attention, right? Right? As he was on the way, literally he fell into blindness. And when the scales were falling off his eyes, he immediately went and studied the scriptures again. Because there was a transformation that was taking place in his life. And where he's at with this this church in Colossae is he is about to give him all his juice, everything that he's got. He's going to unload both barrels. He's going to give them the drink from the fire hose, if you will, when he says what he's about to say in verses 26 and 27. He says this. Let me just back up for 24 and read it right through so you can hear it in context a little more. Now I rejoice in what I am suffering for you, because he was in jail for the gospel. And I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body. He loved the church, which is the church. In verse 25, he says, I have become its servant, the servant of the church, by the commission that God gave me, so as to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed, made known to the Lord's people. To them, that is the church, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles, everyone in the world, the glorious riches of this mystery. What is the mystery? It is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That word mystery is the Greek word mysterion. Mysterion, that word, that's the same word where we get the word mystery from. It's right out of the Greek. That word in the Greek means a secret mystery. A secret, a mystery is secret, okay. A secret mystery. through the idea of silence imposed by initiation into religious rites, a religious mystery. You see, Paul's use of this word is intentional. To a Hellenistic, to a Greek world, when he uses this word mystery, it's like he learned this from the Lord, and it was like this redemptive gift that the Greek culture had, because in their ancient religions, in their mysterious religions, or in their Gnostic religions, it was the way to do it. Their religions were, they had secret rites and secret incantations and secret rituals that you could believe or follow their ideology. But when you got to a certain level, you could get into the in crowd if the mysteries of this religion or this ideology were revealed to you. But you had to work for it in these Greek religions. And so what Paul was doing when he's using this word, he was about to give a radical contrast to that worldview and that culture and way of thinking when it came to the mystery religions. Because you see, in those religions, you were sworn to silence. And then in your silence, you had something over everyone else that was either in your group who didn't have the mysteries, and especially for those that weren't in your group, then you were just above them altogether. It was the Illuminati, basically. Joking. I just said that for my children. Okay. Search it. Google it. No, don't. It's just... But what God was doing in Christ was that he was, yes, there was a mystery, something that was hidden that God was doing that was going to be revealed. And we learn this in passages of Scripture in the Old Testament, like Isaiah chapter 7. Okay, remember in Isaiah chapter 6, where Isaiah the prophet is hoping that his cousin Uzziah was going to become this righteous king and kind of put Israel back in the right standing with God, and that he was going to be the one. And then Uzziah kind of messed up and Uzziah dies. And Isaiah's like praying and he's like, now what, Lord? And as he's praying and trying to figure out what was happening, we have that incredible passage of Scripture that says in Isaiah chapter 6, in the year that Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And Isaiah begins to tell this story of being literally lifted into the heavenly places and seeing God in his throne room, and literally that there's smoke and there's seraphim and these incredible creatures flying in heaven. And one of them goes down and takes a coal from the altar and touches it to his lips and causes him to be from the status of unclean to clean in the presence of the Lord. Then he hears God speaking, and God says, who will go for us? And who will be the one who will speak for us? And Isaiah says, I'm here, send me. Remember that portion of Scripture? Yeah. Well, it goes on to say, if you went after he is sent, it goes right into where he is in the midst of the people and beginning to minister to them. And it is in Isaiah chapter 7 where the revelation begins, that when the people are ever seeing but not understanding, they get this message from Isaiah, and this is what Isaiah says. It says, the virgin will give birth, and that child's name will be Emmanuel, God with us. Guys, mystery revealed. They should have known, but they were like, what? Huh? I don't get it. What are they talking about? Virgin having a baby? Doesn't make sense. You're a crazy man. Shut up. Right? Like, they didn't get what he was saying, but oh, it was written, he was the mouthpiece, and the mystery was beginning to be revealed even in those days. And listen, guys, we could exhaust. There are hundreds of references in the prophets to these predictions about the mystery, Jesus, okay? So Paul became a minister of this mystery. And so the nice thing is that he didn't hide it, because this wasn't about, if you want to be in the in crowd in the messianic community, then come over here and I'll tell you some cool things about Jesus that nobody else knows. No, he did exactly what Jesus said to do. He who has this truth doesn't hide it under a bushel. Thank you. Doesn't hide it under a bushel, no, right? But puts it on a lampstand for all the world to see, okay? So look at what he says. I'm going to give you a bunch of places in the New Testament where he talks about the mystery. So we don't just have to look at this spot in Colossae. This is a theme, a main major theology of Paul the Apostle. The man who wrote two-thirds of our New Testament was throwing out seeds of this mystery everywhere that he talked. He was revealing this to everyone because it wasn't a hidden thing. He was shouting it to the rooftops, to the four corners of the world, and he was literally bearing in his body what yet had to be accomplished in order for this truth to go to the ends of the earth. What a cool guy. Look what he said in Romans 16, 25 and 26. He says, "Now to him who is able to establish you in accordance with my gospel," wow, God, who is going to work it so you will be established in the gospel, "the message I proclaim about Jesus Christ in keeping with the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all the Gentiles," everyone else, me and you, not just the Jew, "might come to the obedience that comes from faith." Wow, this little portion of scripture right here, these two verses, have packed in them literally the gospel of the gospel. That by faith, you and I can apprehend what God has been doing mysteriously through all the ages and has now been revealed, and that literally you and I are going to become a revelation of it. If you choose to say yes to Jesus and let him be the Lord of your life that he should be, then what will take place is you will become a revelation of the mystery. You will be a proclamation to all around you of the mystery. By the way, this is why the gospel works. When you share the gospel, just a portion, a little piece of the gospel, and you plant it somewhere, and you go on and you go, "Oh, that really didn't work. I wish it had been done something more." No, no, no. You understand. You planted a seed where the Holy Spirit, God, is responsible for the increase. God does it. And sometimes you're just walking along and you find somebody who is full of these seeds, and the Holy Spirit's just been like, glung, 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 sunlight, 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 glung, 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 right? And all of a sudden, you're walking along and you have the opportunity to pray with somebody when they come to that point where they say yes to Jesus, and you go, "Wow, is evangelism that easy?" Yeah, it's that easy, because the Holy Spirit is working all the time to convict the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment to come. And all we got to do is plant the seeds and make ourselves available to be a revelation of the mystery revealed. Pretty cool. Did you know this was your job? Did you know this is who you are? Romans 16, 25 and 26 is just one of the places where Paul talks about the mystery. Paul often uses this word mystery. In fact, in the New Testament, there are approximately 20 places the word mysterion is used. 15 of the 20 belong to Paul the Apostle. 15 of them. Only two of them belong to Jesus. Huh, that's cool. Three to the Apostle John. And there might be a few more, but the major groupings are right there. There's about 20 of them. In fact, listen to this. In Matthew 13, verses 10 through 17, I'm just going to read this through really quick. You don't have to put this up. Matthew 13, 10 through 17. The disciples came to Jesus and said, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" This is what Jesus said. "Because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, my apostles, but not to them." It was actually the Jews. It was actually the Pharisees. What? Hadn't been given to them? What did he mean by that? Didn't they not have the scriptures? Yes, of course they did. But he goes on to say, whoever has will be given more, and they will have in abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. You see, Jesus had just shared the parable of the sower, right? The seeds being sown in different soils. And some people call it the parable of the soils. Because what he was saying is that this seed is going to be cast out to everyone, but it's the condition of the heart that determines whether or not you can bear its fruit. And what was happening at that time for the Jews, for the Pharisees, of which Saul of Tarsus was one, their hearts were hard. The seed was given to them, but their hearts were hard and they could not receive it. They were using it for their own glory, not for the glory of God. Though seeing, they do not see, he said. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. You know who he's quoting right there? Isaiah from chapter 7. That's pretty cool. That was like a Bible studier's geek moment right there, okay? In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will ever be hearing but never understanding. You will ever be seeing but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused, hard. They hardly hear with their eyes, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. You see, the phrase there is that understand with their hearts, and the word turn is literally the same word for repent. And when he says, I would heal them, means I would restore them. That I would restore to them everything that I promised, but yet their hearts were hard to receive my promises. What were the promises? Covenants. But he says to his disciples, because he knew what was going to happen, remember what Jesus prayed in John 17. He says, I have fully disclosed to them, the ones that you have given me, what you required of me, Father. And he said this, as recorded in Matthew 13, 16, but blessed are your eyes, he said this to his disciples, because they do see, and your ears because they do hear. For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. So yes, very much like in the Hellenistic Greek style, there was a mystery that was about to be revealed, but it wasn't just for the elite. It was for all. It wasn't just for the Jew. It was for the Jew, absolutely, and for the Gentile, the whole world. This was the mystery being revealed, right? Look at Galatians 3, 7 and 8. Galatians 3, 7 and 8 is, again, Paul the Apostle teaching another church that is actually in the same region as the church of Colossae. And what he says to them, this is one of Paul the Apostle's earliest writings, and he is hot at this church. He's like angry mad. He's like angry writing. He's angry texting. You know what I'm saying? You know what those are like, right? I mean, there would have been a lot of, yeah, all caps and some pretty awkward, you know, emojis if he had had them. All right? He was giving it to him. But in doing so, I know this is, yeah, that's between the lines, sorry. In doing so, he's building to a moment with the Galatians where he's saying, look, he's going to talk about the mystery revealed, but he's going to do it in a very direct way. And then I'm going to take you somewhere in the scriptures, okay? So shake it off if you're already getting too comfortable. Somebody open a window. Somebody open a window. This is important. Galatians 3, 7 and 8, he says, understand this then, that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Amen. Scripture foresaw. Scripture. He's not referring to his own writings, my letters. He's referring to the Holy Scriptures, right? The Torah. He's saying the Scriptures foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith. What? Scriptures did this? And announced the gospel? Announced the gospel in advance to Abraham. When he did it, he said it like this. And then literally Paul writes to the Galatians. He He quotes Genesis 12. He says, all nations will be blessed through you. How many nations?
All.
Wow. Wow. So that those who rely, trust in, cling to faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. From Abraham came Jacob. Jacob became Israel. Israel's 12th son became the nation that we know as Israel. And yes, they were and are the chosen people of God. However, in this passage, it was faith. It was the faith of Abraham that gave him the benefit of the promises that God had given him. God said, I'm going to do it. And then he watched to see how Abraham would respond. And we're going to find out that the scriptures say that Abraham heard what God said. By the way, God had to say it to Abraham like seven times. Like a bunch of times, at least five times specifically, where he told Abraham, I'm going to bless you, man. I'm going to bless you. And Abraham kept going, well, wait, if so, then how come, how's it going to work? And he kept really making mistakes, which we're going to look at some of those passages. We won't look at them in their entirety, but I'll give you the addresses. And God kept coming to Abraham because, you see, God was the initiator of the covenant. There was nothing special in Abraham that drew God to Abraham. God chose Abraham because God decided to do it. He said, that's the one I'm going to choose. And he chose Abraham, and Abraham actually responded appropriately. And this is, again, a miracle that he did this, okay? So he responds favorably to God. All nations will be blessed through you, so that those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith, being that Abraham, through whom Israel would become, would come, that both Israel, who is blessed because they are children of Abraham and they become Israel, that it is because Abraham had that faith. Listen to Genesis 12, 2 and 3. This is the first mention of the Abrahamic covenant. I will make you, said the Lord, into a great nation, Abram, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. Wow. What a promise. If I was Abraham, I think it was a good thing for him to respond favorably there. He's getting a really good deal. Okay? And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Genesis 17. God again comes to Abraham. Look at 17, 1 through 7. I'm going to read it really quick. When Abraham was now 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and I will greatly increase your numbers. Abraham fell face down, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. I will be the father of many, you will be the father of many nations. Verse 5, no longer will you be called Abram. No, your name will be Abraham. For I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you. He did not say that to Moses. He said it to Abraham. I will make, he says, an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. Wow. God is giving at this moment in Abraham's life when he's 99 a promise that Abraham cannot wrap his mind around. In fact, I forgot to mention to you, Genesis 15. There was a moment in Abram's life where he had to go and rescue his nephew Lot, because Lot had a real panache for getting in trouble. And so he goes and rescues Lot. And when he does, he conquers five kings along the way, and he takes a ton of plunder. And when he does this, he's going back to his home. And on the way back to his home, he had to go through an area called Salem. And the problem at being a warring party coming back from war, coming through Salem, is that Salem was had a king who was called the King of Peace, which basically means the king who's conquered everybody. He's made peace in the land, right? The King of Peace. By the way, don't mess with the King of Peace because he's conquered everyone. And now this clown is coming through with a warring party, and he's got to go through here, and he's like, uh-oh, I'm nervous. And so what he does is he takes an inventory of all that he had plundered, and he takes the absolute best of it, 10% of it, which this was their custom. He took 10% of it, the absolute best of all, that 10%, and he showed it to Melchizedek, the king of Salem, and said, by the way, me, my men, and all of our plunder are your servants, and this is all of me. He didn't give him 10% as a toll because Melchizedek was some ogre at the bridge. You know what I'm saying? He said, I surrender all. And he gave him all. And when he did that, Melchizedek came out with bread and oil, and he anointed him. He anointed him. And he said, yeah, thank you for the tithe. Thank you for your all. I'll take that. And now that's sufficient. And in kind, I'm going to cut covenant with you. The symbols of the bread, the wine, the oil were literally the images of the New Testament covenant that we have. And you know who Melchizedek was, right? It was Jesus. It was Jesus, right? So he sees Jesus in that moment, and Jesus cuts a covenant, if you will, with Abraham, which was pointing forward to the new covenant. Abraham had no clue. And in that moment, or just after that moment, Abraham went on, and it says, Abram believed the Lord, and he, it's blah, 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 blah. Let me back up. Genesis 15, 16 through 18. God had spoken to Abraham again and confirmed that he was going to cut a covenant with him, make a covenant, an everlasting covenant with him, make him great and give him land. And then in verse 6, we pick up in Genesis 15, 6, and he says, Abraham believed the Lord, and he, God, credited to him, Abram, as righteousness. This is that passage that's also mentioned in the book of Hebrews in the New Testament that's saying that that was the moment that Abram was born again. Born again. Because he believed God at his word. And so he also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldees to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abraham said, Sovereign Lord, here he goes again, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? So the Lord said to him, and this is the moment, man. This is the cool, one of the coolest images in Genesis, in the entire book, other than the actual creation. This moment is where the sovereign God, that creator God, says to Abraham, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abraham brought all these to him. He cut them in two and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abraham was there, driving them away, preserving them, because he was told by God to do this, and then he just did it, and he protected these things. And then it says, as the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years, your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish that nation that they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. You know there's a lot there. But what God is doing is he's giving him a revelation of the future. He is giving him a mystery that will be revealed, if you will. Then the sun set and darkness had fallen, and a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared as though it was floating and passed between these two pieces. And on that day, God made a covenant with Abraham. That is the very moment where God says, tell you what, let's go on the ritual of covenants that says when we cut a contract, if one of us breaks the contract, then you will be like these animals, right? And God says, I make an everlasting covenant with you. And if I break this covenant with you, Abraham, then let me be accursed. Let me suffer death, which wasn't going to happen. But he was giving Abram a symbol, and what he said, know this with certainty, what I am telling you will take place. Wow. God is the initiator of his promises, and when he makes his promises, he finishes what he begins. He goes on in Genesis 22, why am I laboring this so hard? I thought we were in Colossians. I'm laboring this so hard. Because you've got to know, this is the revelation that Paul the Apostle didn't know. And now he's giving this to these people who are Gentiles. And he's saying that the certainty that God made a promise to Abraham is the same certainty that he is giving to you. Genesis 22:17-18. God says, God, I will bless you. I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. And through your seed, your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. Through your seed, the word there in the NIV says offspring and makes it in the plural. But most other translations say seed in the singular, speaking of Christ. Ephesians 1:7-10, let's go back to what Paul was writing in this revelation that he had about the mystery. He says, in him, Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. This might be one of the best portions of scripture that reveals what the mystery is. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. Verse 9, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. So Christ literally is the mystery revealed. He is the object, if you will, of the new covenant. He is the sacrifice of the new covenant, and he is the mediator of that new covenant. And when he does it, he comes. Because remember, in Jesus' words, they don't get it. Their eyes are veiled. They can't understand it. They have darkened their eyes and they have stopped their ears. They're refusing to hear my word. But I'm going to do it anyway. That was the cool thing. He thought, well, they're not going to listen, so I guess we're not going to Disneyland. You know, that's how we treat our kids. If you're good, then we'll go. No, God had bigger plans. He was like, I made a promise to Abraham, and I will fulfill it. He didn't just fulfill it in giving Abraham a son. He fulfilled it in giving Abraham a heritage. And that heritage wasn't just going to be what became the Jews or Israel. That heritage was going to be all nations, be put in effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven on earth under Christ. He goes on to say in Ephesians 3:4-6, is this too much? Okay, all right. In reading this then, Paul says, you will be able to understand my insight, Paul says, into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to peoples in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit of God's holy apostles and prophets. Verse 6, this is so hot. This is so good. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs. Is there a period there? No, wait, there's no period. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel. Oh, this is where the Abrahamic covenant, we are not, I have to say this, the church is not a replacement for Israel. It is a fulfillment for Israel. You got to get that. You got to get that this was God's plan from the beginning. Together with Israel, members together of one body. Here comes the body. One body and sharers together in the promise of Jesus Christ. This is the church. Guys, did you know that there are three ethnicities in the New Testament? Three major ethnicities in the New Testament. This is a weird thing that I'm going to say right now. Okay? I should have given you an overhead for this. But there's three ethnicities. One is the Jew. That's a very clear ethnicity. Now, there's a lot of other nation states mentioned. But the second ethnicity is everybody else, Gentile. But the third ethnicity is one new humanity. Me and you. The church. With Israel. They're not excluded. And we don't get to be under them. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free, male nor female. All are one in Christ. This is good news. And this is what Paul was saying when he said, oh, wait, are we in Colossians? Okay, I'll go back there. Why don't we stand to our feet? Why don't we stand to our feet? Guys, thank you so much for going to Sunday school this morning. Thank you for letting me give you all these verses. I hope that your heart is being filled with God's intention for you, that he's focused on you. This weird religion about Moses and sacrificing bulls and goats and doing this whole thing and circumcision for men. Guys, is it weird? Anyone? Is it weird? Am I the only one? Okay, in my Gentile mind, it took me a long time to get this. But what God was doing in Israel was he was creating a moment in time until the fullness of time had come where his people could have relationship with him. And in the fullness of time, he would come to a place where he would fulfill what he promised to Abraham, his everlasting covenant. Guys, this is so good. He says in Colossians, this is where we're ending up. He says in Colossians, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but now is disclosed for the Lord's people. Verse 27, to them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery. He included us with the ones that he has chosen, and all we have to do is have the faith of Abraham. It is by faith that we are in this family. And he goes, look what he says in 27. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles, me and you, the glorious riches of this mystery. What is the mystery? It is Christ in you, the hope of glory. I'm sorry, but when I look at you, look at your neighbor. I mean, is that glory? All right? Okay, there's a few bald guys in the room, and they got a shiny dome, and you see some glory. But the rest of them, you're like, I don't know. Maybe you got a nice set of teeth there, and you smile, and you're like, wow. I'm like Jason, where are you at? Jason, you have perfect teeth, right? Like glory, glorious, right? But what is the glory? What is this glory statement? This glory statement, guys, here's a whole nother sermon. Maybe I should just go off on this next week. Ephesians 2:15, Jesus said, by setting aside in his flesh, Jesus, setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. He didn't just set them aside, you guys. That phrase, set aside, means that he fulfilled them all so that they became second to what he was about to administer. Therefore, whew, here it is. By setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulation, the curse that had us under its thumb, his purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of two, both the Jew and the Gentile, thus making peace between them. How did he make peace? Because he is the king who conquered all. He is Melchizedek. He made the peace. He goes on to say to the church at Corinth as he reveals this mystery a little more, he says, therefore, since we have this hope that Jesus has done this, we use great boldness. We don't hide the mystery. Unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadfastly at what was passing away, but their minds had been blinded. For until this same day, a veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament because the veil has been taken away in Christ. Guys, to this day, listen to me, listen. In this day, there are still those of the house of Israel, the Jew, who are waiting for a Messiah. They're thinking that the law, that something might happen in the law of Moses to bring the fulfillment of their Messiah. But my heart absolutely breaks. Because a nation, right, listen, I'm about to get political and I don't mean to, but the reality is, in time, right now, Israel is at war. On October 7th, I waited more than 2 weeks to say anything about Israel. I got a lot of flack from a lot of people in my world about saying nothing. But I was fearful in a righteous sense that I knew that Israel could end it quickly. And they didn't. They had moral restraint. And that made my heart glad. And it gave me a way to pray because I didn't know what I was praying for. But again, anyone who curses you will be cursed. Anyone who blesses you will be blessed. And so I pray for the nation of Israel. But let me explain to you what I'm praying for Israel. That their current situation would turn their hearts to the Lord. There are specific things that we can pray about what is literally taking place in real time. And we should pray that lives would be saved and not lost in all of humanity, both Jew and Gentile. But the reality is this, that this truth, even to this day when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. And where the Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. But we all with unveiled faces beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as the Spirit of the Lord says or does. There is a glory that can abide in me and you that comes from God. There are things going on in the earth that we cannot understand, but we can know this. There are three ethnicities in the New Testament. The Jew, the Gentile, and you and me. It is our responsibility to be a revelation of the mystery revealed. And as we go and do that, a glory and a liberty, a freedom will abide on us, in our communities. Oh, guys, the mystery revealed is more than just Jesus dying on the cross. It is one new humanity, me and you together in harmony. There are things going on in the world, but Christ is the head of the church, and he is the King of Peace. I don't know where to go from here. I hope that you've received a word today. I hope that you've understood how critical and important you are to the Lord, and that you have an assignment from Him. We've talked about forgiveness right at the beginning. And in that grace that you have been given, that you give it out to others and it become a revelation of the mystery of God's long-suffering, kindness, and mercy to the whole world. I do want to say that we do need to pray for the nations of the world. We need to pray for Israel. We need to pray that their moral restraint will remain, but that also humanity will not be lost. My heart breaks over the things that are going on in the world right now. But moreover, the things I can do, I can pray, but I can also be a light right now in my community, in my house, in my job, to the world. Amen. All right, let's sing this song together.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who.